An archetype is a primal pattern that exists in the four-dimensional realm and is expressed in the third dimension through symbol, thought, speech, behavior, art, etc. We are always expressing a specific archetype. Primal archetypal templates equip us with lenses that we may personally glean our cosmic potential and divine attributes. They are a way to focalize intent on behalf of humanity. The principle of the archetype traces back to the ideas of Plato, when he speaks of everything in this world having its ideal prototype in another world and in another dimension. Plato stated that the primal being is the emanation of the demiurgic mind, nous, which contains from eternity the idea of the to-be-created world within itself. This is what Carl Jung later referred to as the world of archetypes. In Jung's definition, archetypes refer to a primal persona or personality. Different people embody specific archetypes and play out these roles in a social organization. Jung said the archetype was the result of countless experiences of our ancestors. They are, as it were, the psychic residues of numberless experiences of the same type. Joseph Campbell built on the work of Jung's concept of the collective unconscious to encompass the world's mythologies. Campbell studied world mythology, religion, and art to discover the common thread woven throughout. He sought to find the commonality of themes in world myths, pointing to a constant requirement in the human psyche for a centering in terms of deep principles, the power of myth. Campbell focused much on the hero archetype. He felt the function of the hero was to pull together all these tendencies to separation, to pull them together into some intention. According to cosmic history, an archetype is the entitization of a specific configuration of primordial space capable of performing a cosmic function. New galactic archetypes are needed to raise the human frequency and lead us across the bridge to the new time-space. These new galactic archetypes are the tellers of the new stories, the tales of tomorrow. Archetypes are projected through an act of creative will that links lower mind with higher mind, or ego consciousness with archetypal consciousness, in elevating ourselves into higher consciousness, reinforced by right thought. We join the great company of those whose will is consciously divine and who are the custodians of the plane, as Alice Bailey phrases it. An archetype is first a formalization. A formalization is a form created from the interaction of various wave motions or patterns. These patterns establish a structural field that holds memory or configuration of meaning for what that field might contain. Number is the measure of movement. Number combines with space and time to create form. This form then becomes quantifiable number, so there is number as frequency oscillations, and number as quantifiable forms or geometries. These quantifiable forms represent the crystallization of primal sound resonance into points of matter. See Cosmic History Chronicles, Volume 2. This formalization then acquires intrinsic qualities required by a particular stage in the dimension of evolvement to perform different functions of intelligence. Every person plays out one or more archetypal roles at any given time. Some examples of these archetypes are prophet, avatar, world teacher, magician, priest, poet, farmer, navigator, virgin, pathfinder, healer, wizard, seeker, fool, initiate, alchemist, artist, even the trades of commerce, the merchant, the apprentice, the journeyman, etc. The archetype is a prototypal role, a spatial configuration capable of performing a cosmic function. Everyone who incarnates into the endless generations of society and history takes one or more of these archetypal functions. The archetypes as depicted in the tarot come from a much earlier stage of development, or the hieratic stage, where there were stratified classes of people, like the priest class, aristocrats, merchants, peasants, laborers, etc. The rulers, priests, or clerics, who govern society can also be seen in these types. Archetypes are also present in the game of chess with kings, pawns, bishops, knights, etc., which also represent a hierarchic stage of society. Arcana is plural for arcanum, which means profound secret. The basic archetypes appear in the 22 major arcanum of the tarot deck. There is the Fool or Young Seeker, the Magician, the High Priestess, the Empress, the Emperor, the Hierophant, the Lovers, the Chariot, Strength, the Hermit, the Wheel of Fortune, Justice, the Hanged Man, Death, the Devil, the Tower, the Star, the Moon, the Sun, the Judgment, and the World. These are the types of archetypes that have come down in history. Archetypes are fifth ray concretizations of patterns of the Absolute. The fifth ray revolves around concrete knowledge or how we apply knowledge through utilization of the medium of time-space. As fifth ray entitizations, all archetypes represent a descent from a higher dimensional blueprint. Different cycles call for different archetypes. The historical cycle includes the formation of the archetypes, the enactment of the archetypes, the degeneration of the archetypes, and the return or renewal of the archetypes. The 5,125-year cycle can be divided into five 1,025-year cycles. During these cycles, different classes of people arise: the farmer and peasant, merchants, aristocratic class, and often a warrior class as well as a priest class at top. This is a fractal of the five suns. The whole of this cycle creates the fifth sun. The first fifth of this cycle, from 3113 BC to 2088 BC, represents the ascent of history, the construction of civilized society, and the generation of historical archetypes: the Hierophant, Magician, Priest, and High Priestess. Once archetypes are formed and crystallized into formation at the beginning of the second 1025-year cycle of the social historical order, then begins an inevitable decline of the archetypes from a more pristine to a more profane order of reality. When the moon becomes absolutely full, it begins to wane. When the sun reaches its maximum at the summer solstice, the next day is shorter than the one before it. This means that the descent into an ultimate anarchy of the archetypes is naturally inevitable. So we have a hieratic or hierarchical society followed by a slow descent from the hierarchical rule of sacred art into the anarchical rule of cultural disorder. All of history is a degeneration of this process. After the first 1025 years, the ascent of the archetypal functions and then the crystallization, then comes the next four phases that represent the descent of hierarchical society. The Golden and Silver Age goes from BC 2088 to 38. The whole era before Christ is the classic period of hierarchical society. In Earth Ascending, this is seen as the pristine hieratic, and then the imperial hieratic. From 38 BC to 2012, we see the slide into anarchic society. By anarchic, we mean without sacred order. To 38 BC to 987 AD. The next 1025-year cycle is completed when historic Quetzalcoatl renews civilization at Chichen Itza. In Earth Ascending, this is referred to as the cosmopolitical medieval or religious age. This era is dominated by three major religions: Buddhism, Christianity, and Islam. This cycle ends 1000 years before 1987, when the 25-year countdown to the closing of the Great Cycle began. The generation of the archetypes first occurs in the Old World. What we call the civilization of the New World is only half the duration of the whole scale. Its archetypes crystallize about the time of the first of the inscriptions that show the long count, and Teotihuacan was preparing for its full manifestation, about 38 BC. What starts in the Old World, BC 2088, begins in the New World at 38 BC. The midpoint between 987 and 2012, the last fifth, is the year 1499. This is precisely when the conquest of the New World begins. When we get past this point, the slide into anarchy and the descent into hell becomes coalescent into one process. The midpoint between 1499 and 2012 is 1807. At this point, the cycle is rapidly consuming itself in the industrial dark age of iron. At this last stage comes the complete separation and degeneration of religion from the natural processes, as well as the development of the sixth ray idealism. Religion evolves into forms of sectarism and fanaticism. This is the only way it can continue to affect the world. The aristocracy becomes world imperialism and the oligarchy of money. The merchant class becomes the triumphant class, in the sense that all the bodies are oriented to middle-class comfort, while the farmer and peasant class become the proletariat class, engendering the mass mind. This is the mind that prevails today. At this final stage, the archetypes have degenerated into roles known as pop stars or celebrities. This completes the process of archetypal generation to degeneration. Archetypes originally represented manifestations of the absolute. Once they incarnate into the relative world, they come an inevitable degeneration. This is the process and program of the historical society. Quetzalcoatl is a multidimensional being. The spirit of Quetzalcoatl was known to the people of Mexico before the incarnation of the actual culture bringer in 947 of the Christian era. This Quetzalcoatl, the long-awaited one, lived the archetypal pattern, bringing great forms of art and culture. The year 987 marks 1025 years before the end of the cycle 2012. This is the point that the historical Quetzalcoatl, who had now left Tolan, arrived in Chichen Itza to renew the pattern. This is the pattern that comes from Tolan and the New World. Here, the beginning of the last fifth of the cycle mimics the beginning of the fifth sun in BC 3113. The Old World is characterized by Babylonian civilization and the New World by cosmic civilization of the Maya, the descendants of Tolan. The Old World conquers the New World beginning in 1499. The New World never got the chance to be the New World for the whole world. In this sense, Quetzalcoatl is the supreme archetype of the complete spiritual journey, for he has yet to return. Here there is a remarkable coincidence with the prophecy of the return of Christ. The graphic from one of the Mexican codices, the Vienna Codex, shows Quetzalcoatl in the celestial realms receiving instruction from the star elders, then descending on the ladder of avataric descent. Once on the plane of history, Quetzalcoatl is guided by celestial forces as he sets off on his world mission. History is the context of the spiritual journey. As the archetypes degenerate, the spiritual force enters in to redeem and lift up as much as it can the degenerated forces that have affected the decline of the power of the archetypes. Quetzalcoatl is the archetype of spiritual and cultural renewal, who vows to return at the end of history. Following the descent from the Absolute, Quetzalcoatl is born as an anticipated type of Messiah. In his birth, he conforms to an archetypal pattern already established. His mission is to renew the culture. He receives the instruction from the elders of different traditions. He founds the city of the new Tolan, Tula, but then has a fall from grace. He departs and goes on a wisdom quest and leaves teachings everywhere he goes. He ends up at Chichen Itza in 987, which had been abandoned in 692. At that point, he renews and revivifies Mayan culture, which had been abandoned since the departure of the Galactic Maya in 830. All of this has been foreseen. After he bequeathed to the people a new cultural legacy, then he departs for the Eastern Sea in 999, giving prophecies for when he will return some thousand years later. Though his historical incarnation, he follows the pattern of culture bringer and culture renewer, the highest archetypal function. Quetzalcoatl is many and he is one. His message is peace, and he knows the method of return. This is the great secret. In his destiny, he was the punctuation mark inaugurating the last fifth of the archetypal cycle of history. In this sense, this last stage of history, 987-2012, is the cycle of Quetzalcoatl. In the final stage leading to 2012, we complete the fifth sun and usher in the sixth sun of total renewal. This is brought about through the reorganization by a universal plan of unification in which the old timespace is dissolved and the new one takes its place. The template of this renewal plan is known as the Hunapku 21, the prophetic tradition of the Galactic Maya. The Hunapku is the one giver of movement in measure. Movement is time, measure is space. Tolan is the template of order that creates the pattern and environment for the new archetype to evolve. The heavenly Tolan is organized as four outer courts with a fifth inner court. The fifth inner court contains the primal and secondary heart and light energy cells, which activate electromagnetic circuits connecting the five courts. This is the same image of the heavenly court as five great domes. In this heavenly Tolan, there is a renewal of the archetypes. In the celestial pattern of heavenly Tolan, there are 21 archetypes that correspond to 21 stations or articulations of the energy flows that make up the inner etheric grid of the human body, the outer and the inner. The outer environment is a reflection of the inner etheric body that receives its own projection back as a reflection of the environment in which it is evolving. The 21 articulations account for 4 gates of light, 4 gates of power, 4 sources of power, 4 matrix gates, and 5 seats of power. These are the archetypal stations. When the archetypal pattern becomes conscious as time calls it forth, the human personages appear to fulfill their archetypal power. In the 10th century, it was Quetzalcoatl, the serpent initiate king of Tolan, who embodied the supreme example of this function. In the Kabbalah, there are 22 pathways that connect the 10 Sephirot, and that correspond to the 22 major arcanum in the Tarot. In the vision of the celestial Tolan, there are 21 Sephirot, or archetypes, and 52 paths that connect them. In this way, the 52 paths that connect the 21 archetypes function as each one of the 52 weeks in a year. These archetypes are engendered for the sixth sun of consciousness. Tolan is the organization of the 21 archetypes and their 52 paths of interconnectedness. There are 21 base numbers that represent the unity of totality. 20 represents totality plus 1 equals unity. The unity of totality, 21, represents the 20 solar seals plus Hunapku. 1. Primal Force, also known as Dragon, Ancient of Days, and Galactatron by name. Establishing the court of the Avatar, Dragon gives birth to the knowledge and holds the position of the first light gate, the Markapole, at the North Galactic Pole. The Primal Force exemplifies being as knowledge. 2. High Priestess, also known as the Wind Spirit Essence, and Lady of the Winds by name. She establishes the court of the prophet and holds the power and spirit of prophecy at the second light gate, the Dark Pole, the South Pole of the Galactic Order. The High Priestess exemplifies spirit as the command of prophecy. 3. Dreamer, also known as the Knight or the Psychic Presence by name. As the bestower of riches, both spiritual and material, the dreamer invokes the court of the Compassionate One with the dream of love. The dreamer activates the centrifugal force and holds the position of the third light gate. The dreamer exemplifies abundance as the intuition of love. 4. Innocent One, also known as the Seed, the Seeker, and the Holy Fool by name. The Innocent calls for the court of the Pathfinder and the awareness of intelligence. The Innocent One activates the centripetal force and holds the station of the fourth light gate. 5. Serpent Initiate, also known as the Serpent, guardian of the Covenant and keeper of the primal wisdom of the fifth root race, and Red Enigma by name. Serpent Initiate is the generator of the red electrical circuit and holds the first gate of power in the court of the Avatar. The Serpent Initiate exemplifies sex as the beginning of knowledge. 6. Hierophant, also known as the World Bridger, revealer of the sacred, holder of the treasury of death, and the Great Equalizer by name. The Hierophant is the guardian of the first source of power in the court of the Avatar and balances the primal force of sex with death. The Hierophant exemplifies death as the source of knowledge. The Hierophant holds the key to the treasury of revelations. 7. Avatar, also known as the Hand, accomplisher of knowledge, and Exemplar by name. The Avatar holds the first seat of power in the court of the Avatar, taught by the Serpent Initiate. The Avatar receives directly the knowledge revealed by the Hierophant. The Avatar exemplifies cosmic knowledge. 8. Artist, also known as the Star, keeper of beauty, and Star Singer by name. The Artist is the Master Builder and holds the position of the second gate of power within the court of the Compassionate One. The Artist exemplifies the resonant power of art as the beginning of love. 9. Healer, also known as the Moon, Purifier, Naturalist, Guardian of the Moon, and Moon Priestess by name. The Healer holds the second place of power in the court of the Compassionate One. The Healer exemplifies healing as the source of love and is the guardian of the universal water that nurtures and sustains all beings. 10. Compassionate One, also known as the Dog, Peacemaker, Holder of Heart Teachings, and Divine Loyalty by name. The Compassionate One holds the second seat of the power in the court of the Compassionate One. Compassionate One exemplifies the power of love as the unconditional regard for the well-being of all creatures. 11. Magician, also known as the Monkey, Lord of the Game, Shapeshifter, and Blue Alchemist by name. Magician is the generator of the blue electrical circuit and holds the third gate of power in the court of prophecy. As the generator of the blue electrical circuit, the Magician complements the Serpent Initiate as the generator of the red electrical circuit. Magician exemplifies magic as the beginning of prophecy. 12. Sage, also known as the Human, Governor, and Wise Judge by name. The Sage is the guardian of wisdom and holds the source of power in the court of the Prophet. The Sage exemplifies wisdom as the source of prophecy, and prophecy as the enactment of wisdom. 13. Prophet, also known as the Skywalker, World Teacher, and Culture Bringer by name. The Prophet holds the third seat of power in the court of the Prophet. Prophet exemplifies the spirit of prophecy as the wisdom of the future made present. 14. Wizard, also known as the White Wizard, Knower of Mysteries and Northern Light by name. The Wizard opens the fourth gate of power in the court of the Pathfinder. The Wizard exemplifies timelessness as the beginning of intelligence. Only by being still and receptive can the intelligence of timelessness arise. 15. Seer, also known as the Eagle, Visionary, Star Emissary, and Skyborn by name. The Seer is the guardian of the fourth source of power, Vision, in the court of the Pathfinder. The Seer exemplifies Vision as the source of intelligence. Without Vision, there is no intelligence. 16. Pathfinder, also known as the Warrior, the Intelligence Agent, the Cosmic Scientist, and Codebreaker by name. The Pathfinder holds the fourth seat of power in the fifth court, the Court of Hunavku. Pathfinder exemplifies intelligence as the synchronization of fearlessness with the unknown. 17. Navigator, also known as Earth, Galactic Navigator, Keeper of the Synchronic Codes and Synchronotron by name. The Navigator opens the first matrix portal in the fifth court, the Court of Hunavku. Navigator exemplifies synchronicity as the intelligence of the Hunavku. 18. Yogi, Yogini, also known as the Mirror, Meditation Master, Holder of the Transcendent Wisdom, Mindborn by name. Yogi Yogini opens the second matrix portal in the fifth court, Court of Hunavku. Yogi Yogini exemplifies meditation as the knowledge of Hunavku. 19. World Changer, also known as the Storm, Transformer, Master Alchemist, Catalyzer, Thunder Voice by name. The World Changer opens the third matrix in the court of Hunavku. The World Changer exemplifies energy and self-generation as the love of Hunavku. 20. Enlightened One, also known as the Sun, Bringer of Higher Truth, Renewer of Life, and Awakened One by name. The Enlightened One holds the fourth matrix portal in the court of Hunavku. Enlightened One exemplifies enlightenment as the prophecy of Hunavku. 21. Hunavku, One Giver of Movement and Measure, also known as Magus of the Infinite by name. Hunavku is beyond form and empowers all streams and fields of knowledge with the galactic treasury of infinite wisdom and knowledge. Magus of the Infinite is merely the one on whom is bestowed the power of guarding the galactic treasure of Hunavku 21. Each matrix portal opens one of the outer courts. The Navigator opens the court of the Pathfinder. The Pathfinder creates possibilities for the Navigator. Yogi Yogini opens the gate to the court of the Avatar. The Yogi Yogini bestows mind-to-mind meditation teachings to the Avatar, empowering the Avatar's knowledge. The Catalyzer opens the court of the Compassionate One. The Catalyzer transmits the catalyzing power of self-generation to the Compassionate One, so that compassion becomes an enduring force of oneness. The Enlightened One opens the gate to the court of the Prophet. The Enlightened One bestows the transmission of light to the Prophet, so that the prophecy bears the seal of truth and is effective in every way. The fifth seat of power is the court of Hunavku at the very center. This archetype representing the Hunavku is the Magus of the Infinite, the Lord of the Cube, or the Teacher of the Unity of Totality. From this center court comes the teachings of the Unity of Totality, which is the reality of Hunavku. We also have an index of the different paths that each of these connect with. The four light gates each have only three paths that connect. The power gatekeepers and sources of power have five paths each. The seat of power have four paths each, and the matrix portals each have eight paths of power. This is a brief run-through of the 21 basic archetypes. There are carryovers of traditional forms of archetypes like the magician, wizard, or seer. However, the Hunavku 21 is a renewal. Why? because we have reached the stage of the degeneration of historical archetypes, where pop stars and celebrities have become the archetypal personas, wiring the consciousness of the mass mind. The 52 paths that connect the 21 different archetypal stations can be followed by anyone who so chooses to learn and identify them. Through the means of the 13-moon calendar or synchronometer, the archetypes can be enacted and lived through each person, so that they do not become specified functions embodied by certain people. All 21 archetypes can be embodied by everyone. These archetypes are doorways into multidimensional reality, where everyone can open up and experience the different hierarchical stages of each of the archetypes. The 21 archetypes and 52 heptad paths exist as a means to help us pass through the dimension of illusion into realms of higher truth. The 21 archetypes and 52 heptad paths provide the interconnection of both the archetypal stations of the inner temple of the human body and the outer temple of the environment. We refer to the outer temple as Tolan. We live in a world glamorized by the realm of lower illusion, where many seek to resemble Hollywood movie stars. In this realm, there is either fame and riches, or there is degradation and despoilment, which people seem equally fascinated by. In this fictitious reality, the expectation that someone who is high today may be brought low tomorrow. Everyone waits to see whether or not these famous characters are able to live the fairy tale life that is projected on them, and endure all the temptations of life that are brought forth. This realm of tabloid archetypes, as portrayed by the media, creates a monumental distraction to keep the mass mind at a certain vibrational frequency, so that it doesn't think about the things that are really important. Throughout human history, there has always been an effort to despoil the earth and to rob the masses of their life force in exchange for money and cheap illusions. In the present time, this has reached a phenomenal level of anarchic degradation. The 21 archetypes and 52 heptad paths exist to transport us from this realm of illusion into higher realities of beauty and truth. In this template of Tolan, connected by 52 paths, the 21 articulations move through the supreme harmonic standard of the 28-day cycle, which creates a projection of higher dimensional order, both in spatial and temporal reality. This template brings forth new levels and states of archetypes that represent different stages of human development and spiritual evolvement. This is necessary to create new structures within the mass mind, lifting it into higher states of consciousness. Where did the idea of the enslavement of the mass mind come from? Should not every human being who exists with a mind and heart have the opportunity to raise him or herself to the same level as all of the greatest masters and teachers? The greatest masters and teachers said that not until the last one is raised up shall the teachings be fulfilled. There is a certain illusion that has been passed through history that the mind cannot rise any higher than its lowest state. This is reinforced through media and marketing, which now dominate the time space with an all-pervasive fog of illusion. For this reason, consciousness is always being brought down to the lower levels and the archetypal functions become lurid and gray. In fact, the archetypal memories are stories of a remote time that probably never existed anyway. the point of bringing in a new post-2012 reality or sixth sun of consciousness is to create a true integration and synthesis of the hieratic order of the spiritual evolvement of different stages. This is the only way to bring about a true democratization of making the hierarchical knowledge available to every being who so chooses. This establishes a time-space that is exalted and ever-inspiring. We see the degradation of archetypes brought to the level of Mickey Mouse. Instead, we must make this hierarchical knowledge available so we can rise to our own evolutionary needs. This is the program of the sixth sun of consciousness. This is brought to consciousness through the program of a 52-week cycle of a 13-moon calendar. By operating within this matrix, everyone can live the enactment of the different archetypal functions and begin to evolve in different levels and states of consciousness embodied by the archetypes. These archetypes represent structures of galactic consciousness, galactic society, and cosmic civilization. These are the enduring, transmigrating archetypes that provide the cultural renewal and sustenance to different solar and planetary realms throughout the cosmos for the purpose of upliftment. Once the energies of the archetypes are thoroughly absorbed and the collective or noospheric mind advances to a certain level, then it goes to another level of transcending and transcendence. The archetypes function in a certain dimension of evolvement, from the third to fourth to fifth dimensions. Once we reach the stage of enlightenment and evolvement, the archetypal functions cease to be necessary unless they are being used as forms of bodhisattva activity for the upliftment of other world systems. We can see different gradations of avatar functions because in some way the archetypes are avataric functions as well. We can distinguish, as Alice Bailey puts it, the cosmic avatars, the solar avatars, the planetary avatars, and the human avatars, which are the legends and the myths. As our consciousness rises, we eventually encounter the level of star consuls, or star masters, like those of Sirius or the Pleiades. These are the higher dimensional supramental levels that coordinate the solar logos, a particular mind that initiates the planetary logos by means of interplanetary archetypes that descend into particular stages. These interplanetary archetypes arrive particularly at the culmination of world cycles, where there is a need for their emergence. The 52 heptad paths provide a common pool of archetypal functions accessible to each and every consciousness. This information is for the upliftment of the spiritual soul and human personality as we move into the noosphere. Tolan in this sense is the establishment of the temple as the medium of outer environment. 144 is the number of the temple. 441 is the number of the matrix time-space in which the temple is embedded. This is the sacred order of reality as a living spiritual environment that allows the human to evolve, the time-space. Tolan is a projection of the body and its inner temple. Each of the 21 archetypal stations correspond to a position in one of the five outer courts. Each station also corresponds to an electromagnetic etheric grid within the body. This is the structure or base plan of the inner temple. When the science of the outer temple coincides with the science of the inner temple, then the time-space becomes objectified as the universal plan of unification. This knowledge provides a template that equalizes the inner temple with the outer temple and the inner etheric body with the outer temple body, so that in becoming equalized, they become objectified as a single unit or unity. In this single unity lies the universal plan of unification. Application of the 21 archetypes of Tolan bring the time-space to life. These archetypes also correspond to the 21 principal articulations within the etheric body. Even as we focus on this text, we are performing an archetypal role. Cosmic history is an interactive, living phenomenon. When we realize this, then we enter a stage of knowing our own multidimensional reality and fully utilizing our vastly untapped capacities of consciousness. Up until this realization, our consciousness has been pressed into a very thin layer of repetitive circuits and loops that constitute the life of the modern cyberspheric planetary human. But now, the lid is coming off, pushing us through the veil of the self-existing consciousness of cosmic order. This information is presented to be lived. This is the full development of the time-space as the fifth ray of consciousness, the science of how we make things concrete in the third dimension. There is no turning back. We must now embody the cosmic order within our every thought form, which then radiates to every cell of our body, permeating our environment, and then transforming the time-space itself.